So today's lecture, many of you, if not all of you, have seen before. Cathy Wei teaches frequently within our department. I always think we don't take advantage of Cathy, all of her talents, like we should. We have grown to rely on her for a lot of our computer graphics kind of courses. But Kathy's actually a very talented designer. She is studying, I believe, as undergraduate training in China in landscape architecture, and then immigrated to the U.S. and has her master's degree from the Harvard Graduate School of Design. And she is a senior landscape architect at HLA Group in Sacramento. And she is, I think, their go-to person as far as working on some of their projects in China. And so we wanted to, I felt like we've been sort of very domestic as far as our approach in this class, if not very California-centric. You know, really thinking about some of the future issues. So really was trying to think of who I could get to come in and really think about some more international kind of issues that the profession should be thinking about and addressing. And so I thought of Cathy and having her come in and talk about some of the projects and some of the things that she's been, some of her experiences and what she's worked on. So welcome, Cathy.
Thanks. Thank you, everybody. So I can't say I'm an expert, really, in international design. First of all, I only worked in China alone. And also, there's many business aspects that designers don't get to deal with, but the owner does. So I'll talk of whatever I know and my experiences are. Let's see what I have today. I guess first I want to talk about landscape architecture as a business in general. It is very much a business, and most of you would leave here and hopefully to work in the field of landscape architecture. And as all business, you want to make a product and turn the products into profit. That's what business does. And the same for landscape architecture. Hopefully you produce good enough plans and services and your knowledge that you'll turn into either profit for you or the profit for your office, obviously. So, then there's like the business are globalized, obviously, everybody knows that. And why does a business want to go abroad internationally? There's three factors I could think of. You want to expand your sales. You want to find more base for your market. Basically, you're expanding a bigger group of people that's potentially going to buy your product. And you're also tapping into resources, either natural resources or human resources. You know, obviously a lot of people have gone abroad to take advantage of the human resource or resources that, you know, not quite available or not as cheap in the U.S. So those are the two reasons. And also you want to minimize risk of your business, and you want to broaden the scope and the markets of your business. However, it is sort of this recent downturn is global, so like at least unless you went to the moon, it's, you know, the same sort of here. And I know a joke that the Chinese people we work with, they said when American sneezes, everybody had fever, so it's the severity is like worse everywhere else. So those are the three things, and those are definitely true for landscape architecture. You know, we want to broaden the market to go abroad, potentially clients overseas. And resource acquisition is less apparent, but our office, you know, definitely are using designers in China. They're Chinese, and they know the market there, and they know the rules and whatnot there. And hopefully you gain some risk, minimizing your risk. So those are sort of an international business. And then what's the same for international business, and what's here is basically you want to have the best you have anywhere. You always want to keep the best quality, you always do a good job. You never know who's watching, who's seeing your work, and so that's universal for any job. And I listed a couple of examples, is basically from, you know, simple sketches, what you do at your desk, to analysis, you know, executions in the field, and renderings. And there's different kinds, all kinds of different ways to present. And you always want to make sure you can, within the resources, do the best you can. And, you know, always be like a basic business model. You want to be honest, you know, with everybody, with your workers, or your clients. That's all universal, how to do a good business. So that's on the products end. And, you know, all the trick is, how do you go with the arrows into profit? Those are the tricks. And I don't have the answer, and everybody have their own answers, and you actually find out. So what's different? And there are many, many things that are different. And I thought this picture is kind of appropriate to show, and is what I took on my last trip there, so I think about a year or so. It's very much had been happening like this in China. That the dramatic overturns and the amount of adjacency that they're in, you know, these mules come in probably in the dark and leave in the dark, and it's illegal for them to on the road, and I don't know how they showed up. They must showed up like before sunrise and ready to haul away the deconstruction materials. And obviously behind it is what's possibly what's going to happen at this site. You know, this is very common in China. So there are a few things up there. I don't know if you can read all that. I'm not going to read that for you. A few of them that I feel like is especially difficult for me in the differences. I don't want to talk about the political system because obviously, you know, everybody knows it's not our topic today. So there is something tricky in those systems. And language is the biggest differences. You know, if you don't have anybody that speaks Chinese, it's going to be hard to do business with Chinese. And also the cultural base differences is very big in general cultures with people, and also sort of the corporate culture, the business culture. There are different things that we take granted of what we do here, like giving people things. It's considered rude to not give your card with two hands to them. So that's like one thing. And also there's many customs and eating that you want to be careful with, and of course you learn as you go along. What else do I think? And Chinese eat a lot, like big banquet is a big thing, especially for important meetings with foreigners. You know, and drinking, so hard alcohol drinking is. I can't do that. I don't drink any, and fortunately my boss do. So he takes all the jobs of chucking down those things with the client. So, you know, those are cultural differences that you might definitely run into. Depends on where you want to do the international business. And so then come down to the business and a lot of things are not quite done with contract, like they're not quite agreed on paper, but they assume that it's good with the word. So this is something that my boss had to get used to, that over here, you know, you have a contract, then you do work. It doesn't quite work that way, so you have to find a balance somehow over there. And also, as well as the legal system, because if you want to sign any contract with either even your partners or the client, you know, the legal system is different. And the trading itself, exporting and importing and wire transferring money or paying for anything, there's a lot of kinks in the middle that need to be worked out. So those are sort of what I could think of that are different and you need to look into if you're interested in international business. You're free to ask any questions if you want in the middle. So, and then I thought about where do you start if you're interested as a student when you get out, if you want to, participate in international practice, you can definitely find a bigger office that has multiple offices worldwide to work for them. That's the easiest way. Or you find a partner that is in the foreign country or from the foreign country that you can work together to form some kind of partnership to get jobs there. Or yourself is from another country that you could definitely try to do that as well. And also you can try international competition, design competitions. Those are good ways, especially as students, to do something with. It's been proven, for different designers to be successful with competitions. So that's sort of what I could think of as a way to start. So we're designers and we like to see pretty pictures, right? So I'm going to show a couple of projects that I did. This first one is Canada. It's the closest you can get for international work. It is a design competition. I entered with a coworker. So let me see if I can use it. Winnipeg. Most people know where Winnipeg is, in Manitoba. It's in the middle of Canada. It's if you think Chicago is cold and windy, think again. It's very, very cold and windy, extremely cold. So this is a sort of important city center of Winnipeg that the intersection of these two roads is considered the center of the city, and it's actually very historical. This is Winnipeg in Indian language means muddy water. That's to where this two river meets. This is where the French settled in early 1700s. So they do have very early history for North America. And the city is having a competition, was having this competition to design the intersection area. So that's a more historical site for here. So let me see what I have here. Okay, so the other designer and I looked at the history of the site, and when you do something, especially foreign, you always want to look at, in other locations, you want to look at the history, culture differences to start with, and that should be your your concept, where the concept comes from. You should have a solid basis. So these are sort of the studies we found. It's a fur trading site on the river. That's where the starting of Winnipeg is. So these are the boats on the very windy, it's a city of wind and water, actually. So it's very windy. The river is a big component for this project. And this is actually the intersection of this design. This woman is walking through this intersection called Protégé in Maine is the street. And you can tell it's significant enough to be on a postage in Canada, so it does have a historical significance. As well, it has a natural history and the Indian First Nation has a history of occupying the site. So these are the whole photos of the First Nation people's building and the natural settings of the adjacent area. So these are things we took as concept and inspirations for our design. And this is a sketch of that intersection. We're thinking of it. This two road now is the new rivers of the intersection where the first trading started. And actually in Chinese feng shui, in current modern times, road replaced river as the transportation route. Then the energy of river is actually applied now to roads in terms of the feng shui study. So that's also something we looked into. So we did drawings and models at the same time, and these are sort of our design of models. We try to use similar landforms on the outside of the street. And, this is the street. These are the two streets. And we use the boat as our concept in this area. So that's like a boat shape moving forward in the landform. Like I said, Winnipeg is very windy and cold, right? And it has a long winter. So people, all these buildings have underground tunnels that connect to them each other. So that's important. So the second level is very important to have underneath the, because people don't want to be outside unless they absolutely have to in the winter. So there's a whole city underground. And we thought, how appropriate, we're going to have a ship and we're going to have the bottom of the ship, and this is the top of the deck of the ship. So that's our design, actually. This centerpiece does, it is like an elevator and stairs that you could go down. And on the four sides of the street, there's actually already elevators and stairs before this. Because we want the pedestrian to kind of occupy the center of the intersection again. So either by, in the summer you could have events on the upper area, and in the winter you could occupy the bottom. Here's the plans of, this is the upper top level, street level, and then we have the bottom level. Bottom level has different, concession, little shops and whatnot that goes around here. And the middle is an open area where the light will come through from this opening opening through a tube and comes down, and you can occupy that center space for events. This is the elevation. That's the tube shape that goes down, and with the there are most bank buildings, government buildings around the site. Yeah, and then these are renderings we did with the model of how it would look like at night, and it has that sort of a movement feeling to this piece in the middle of this modern river. That's all I have. Questions for that?
Two questions. Semi off topic. Number one, what program did you use for that rendering?
Photoshop.
Okay. And then, how did you do in the competition?
We didn't win. it was just, I don't remember, but there's different kinds of awards, and we probably got one of the common ones, and it was displayed at the city.
Other questions?
Yeah. So the elevator in the center of the intersection there, the tube, was that supposed to be metaphorical of the ship?
Yeah, I think it does, but also it's also functioning. It's functioning, and it has this opening of light that it could go through for activities down there. Yeah, the idea definitely came from the ship, where you can come up and down from the deck. All right, so let me show you a couple more that I worked with the office in China. I want to show you more, even the rendering itself versus the project, just because there's something specific in Chinese market that the rendering, the presentation is very, very important. Like, you almost want to top other people on how well you present your work. Sometimes the design itself is not that good, but the presentation is top notch. And somehow that's very, very important to the Chinese client. And so these kind of renderings are pretty common for a project to do. You just need to kind of show them. And none of us in the office did this. These are all hired specialty people in China. They do these kind of renderings. So this is a project, planning project in northeast of China, close to the coast, that they are creating some of these waterways, but this river is there, and they're creating some of these cells of water in this development with a lot of business and a lot of the high rises, especially these ones over here. Those are residential, I think, over here, and some business and ceremonial spaces. And they really want to stress the ecological significance, at least in the design and planning. However it's going to be really implemented, we don't know. But they want, that's like a big thing, sustainability and ecological friendly design is important for them. So that's a master planning, and I believe the Chinese office is working on the small portion of, I couldn't tell you where, a small portion of that. They're working on the actual plan of design. Another project, this is a project in Beijing. It's a big shopping center with hotels and high-end residential all lumped together. It's a developer that specializes in this, and he goes to every city and builds something just similar to this, just like a brand, the big brand of shopping center.
通州商务园滨河景观规划设计。一、项目概况。通州是北京的东部门户，自古就是通经要道，自然条件优越，人杰地灵，是文化和贸易发展的重地。现今通州又成为北京城市规划重点发展的新城之一。通州商务园紧邻通州新城，横跨温榆河两岸，自然景观优美，交通便利。通州商务园具有得天独厚的区位优势，其发展可谓占尽了天时地利人和。建成后的园区将会再现运河之畔的繁荣。温榆河是北京原始河流之一，古名温榆水，意为长久温和善良的河水。温榆河是京杭大运河的起点和重要水源，2000年来，人与自然在河两岸和谐地存在着。今天，温榆河畔的风景依然保持着它自然的神韵。商务园滨河景观带将要表现的就是新时代人与自然和谐互补、可持续发展的生态环境。二、规划理念。滨河景观带将充分利用现有的绿化防护林，保护自然的河流景观，改进温榆河的生息环境和水质。一系列的开放绿地、小型公园和景观节点将由河堤路在河两边串联起来，形成一个既多样又有序的整体景观带。一、保护原有生态地貌。滨河景观带将保持温榆河畔自然的河流景观和湿地，充分利用现有的绿化防护林为背景，注重保护成熟的高大树木。二、可持续发展。滨河景观带占商务园发展面积的1/4左右，是保护和改善温榆河生态环境的一个良好条件。三、环保节能。在滨河景观带中，可以利用湿地净化水，改善河水清澈度，鼓励使用绿色能源，如太阳能、风能和水力，保护和种植乡土植被，来改进温榆河的生息环境和水质。四、运动健康。滨河景观带沿河堤路将建成一系列文化、娱乐和体育活动空间，把休闲运动和对生态保护节能的教育结合为一体。五、历史文脉与现代文化共生。通州丰富的历史文化底蕴是滨河景观带设计理念的灵感。滨河景观带将吸取通州历史文化的精华，以现代的手法和高科技赋予古老的人文景观新的面貌。三、规划分析。一、现状分析。温榆河畔大部分地段仍保持着自然的河流景观，温榆河东岸的湿地应尽量保护和利用。
This is transportation, or more like circulation, on site. This is the red line is actually the levee of the river, and we have secondary and small web road in the end. sort of the structure of this park, river corridor on each side. The whole side covers about 100 acres, I think, on both sides of the river. And we made it into different segments and phases. These are before and after studies and Photoshop studies of what we propose. There is a railroad on site, and we, you know, try to create some kind of buffer to the site. And also, this is a common band of like a 30 meters actually, band of forest on the side. So we want to propose some kind of usage inside there. And the existing wetland, we want to also clean it and propose usage to it. This is also rural, kind of a suburb of Beijing, that it has some kind of a farm usage still. So there are orchards and those are corn. So there are some kind of usage of those that we want to keep in the new design. That's the west. The north is actually, north is this way. So that's the west of the river. There are a couple of bridges we're proposing.
通州商务园区标志塔。 4. 滨河立面及种植分析。 滨河景观带的100米内现大部分为防护林， 树种以白杨、银杏和垂柳等落叶树为主，在适当地段加植常绿、开花及观赏树种，现有林下丛生的地被植物将在开发园路及种植需要时进行清理。 5. 户外运动场地及服务设施分析，建成后沿河堤路将为户外运动爱好者提供一些开放场地 及体育休闲设施。 6. 园区商务用地景观分析，以规划理念为指导，用地四周与园区总体景观保持和谐，内部可由业主进行个性化设计。 4. 规划方案，滨河景观带将在保持原有生态地貌的同时，增加一系列的开放绿地、小型公园 和景观节点，这些景观元素由河堤路在河两边串起来，形成一个既多样又有序的整体景观带。重要景观节点包括滨河开放公园、朝阳北路跨河公路桥、商务园主入口、滨河观景高地、展示中心、园区标志景观塔和东西向贯穿景观带。一。 滨河开放公园，滨河景观带最东南端为通顺路开始，这片绿地北临居住和购物中心用地，适宜于居民的活动和小型商业活动。河堤路以北在保护和美化原有植被的同时，在树林中形成几个开放绿地，其中包括篮球场、足球场和儿童游戏场。 这里就是温玉河的最下游大运河的起点。回顾古运河的风貌，大小船只来来往往，帆杆林立，人流熙熙攘攘，就此为启发，在公园的中心以一只大船甲板帆杆为形象来源，再现古风。平台一层可作为小型咖啡厅。 新兴的绿色能源可以减少人对自然的侵害。临水平台的棚顶可以使用太阳能屋顶。临水 Z 字形木栈道为居民提供了在水边漫步的优美环境。二，朝阳北路跨河公路桥节点。朝阳北路是进入通州商务园的主入口，和穿过园区的城市干道。 入口新桥的设计沿用了中国传统拱桥的优美线条， 但赋予了它新的尺度和材质。桥的外表以不锈钢材料为主，在夜间灯火的点缀辉映下将更加优美壮观。三，园区主入口。朝阳北路进入园区的主入口以自然的草坡、丰富的种植和开放的空间来体现商务园高品质的办公环境，突出其自然和简洁的特点。路东侧草坡上的一些新型风车轮可以为旁边的喷泉水井发电，路西侧的新月形草坡上可以放置商务园的地标，新月形草坡的内部可为临近的商务金融业办公人员提供室外办公、聚会和停息的场所。四，滨河观景高地。在温榆河东岸河道转弯处视野开阔，地段临近园区主入口朝阳北路跨河公路大桥，在这里将设一滨河观景高地，设计运用了自然柔和的曲线，结合了以农田为起势的铺装图样。五，园区标志景观塔。观景塔将设置在温榆河西岸的滨河景观带中心地段，与展示中心由跨河桥相连。观景塔不仅是商务园的地标，也是通州新城新时代的标记。塔高约60米，观景塔的设计以通州古老的燃灯塔为灵感，商务园的使用者可以在园区内各个地点看到观景塔，塔中将设有电梯，登到塔顶的人可以看到整个商务园和通州新城。六，展示中心及周边湿地。展示中心将是商务园内最早的建筑物，其与周边的环境不仅要为商务园的管理人员提供舒适的办公环境，还需要充分地表现商务园自然简洁的生态理念和高品质的商务办公环境。展示中心门前的弧形大草坪将提供室外聚会娱乐的空间，在湿地旁的河堤路上将增加小型的湿地观景平台，人们在感受湿地及河流景观的同时，可以从信息展板上学习到有关湿地和水域的生态知识。七，东西向贯穿景观带。原有的高压线用地将成为一条贯穿东西向的景观绿带，绿带在河两岸的节点遥河相望，河东岸的景观节点将再次强调表现古运河上翻干林立的繁荣风貌。和西岸遥河相望的是出挑平台的延续，小广场的中心有喷水池，吸引游人驻足。此地段靠近高尔夫球俱乐部和河西岸的金融中心，几处小型商亭将为过往行人和居民提供服务。八，园区标识系统及室外家具。在商务园的几个主要入口将设置明显的标志墙，标志墙将放置在抬高的草坡上，标志的材料以接近自然为本，以木石为主，一些小型的标志牌也可以延续主要入口标志墙的材质和效果。园区内的灯具、室外家具等将注重自然、简洁和现代的特点。九，河堤路断面设计。河堤路及两边的景观将进行统一的改善和美化，河堤路与高尔夫球场交界处将建立美观实用的围栏和灯柱，围栏的设计图案以当地的农田和波纹的形式为启发，灯柱既为行人照明又起到支撑围栏的作用。河堤路另一侧将增加路灯、桌椅和垃圾箱等必要设施。十，水环境治理及保护。整个商务园地面水的良好治理将有助于保持温榆河的生态环境和可持续性发展。规划建议在高尔夫球场水边 创造一些生态小岛，种植可吸收污染的水生植被。这些生态小岛可以起到净水、护堤和增加生息环境的作用。孔子云：“智者乐水，仁者乐山。凭天时，借地利，集人和，拓伟业，惠四海人人志士，展通州无限商机。”